ich heute die vielen Flüchtlinge sehe, die in Deutschland
When I see all the refugees arriving in Germany today, it reminds me of when we fled from Poland to the West when I was a child. How important it was then to not only find a place you could go, but also one where you'd be allowed to stay.
Many of you are probably still worried about your families and other relatives.
We no longer have a home. All the houses in Daraya were destroyed. Mine, those of my children. We have nothing left in Syria. Nothing at all.
When the train arrived at the Friedland transit camp in 1947, it marked the beginning of a new life. That's why Friedland is almost like a birthplace to me.
My name is Kinaz Al-Habal. I fled my home because of the war raging there. I lived with my children in Daraya, near Damascus, which is where I come from. One day, when my grandson was leaving the mosque, he was shot in the back. He was taken to hospital. I feared for his life. The doctors weren't able to remove the bullet from his liver. It's still there. After that, my daughter, his mother, and her husband and their 7 children fled to Lebanon. I was really worried about them. There were so many massacres taking place.
People were being slaughtered.
So many massacres. I lived in constant fear. You lost track of who was killing whom. You lose sight of the truth.
The most frightening thing was having to dodge shells on the way to school to take my final exams. I was so afraid of getting hit by fragments. They can kill you.
Later, I heard from our neighbors that our house had burnt down. Bombs were dropped from the sky on my house, my daughter's house, both my son's houses, my brother-in-law's. They were all destroyed. The regime had given us just 1 hour to leave our homes. At 7 o'clock in the morning, we all fled Daraya together. And right after we were gone, there was a massacre in Daraya.
Welcome to Friedland. I hope you'll be able to relax and get some rest here and gather strength for the next 2 weeks when you'll be our guests here. You've all been given a red sheet of paper that has a time written on it. All the best. See you on Monday.
My name is Jabrail Adam. I come from Al-Hasaka in northern Syria. We are Christian Assyrians. The war forced us to leave our home in Syria. It had become too violent. There were armed gangs and kidnappings. We escaped to Lebanon and stayed there for 2 years. We registered with the UN Refugee Agency, and that's how we managed to get to Germany. From the airplane, we could see that Germany is a very green and beautiful country. We hope we'll be allowed to stay and to work. We'd like to become independent. We don't want to be a burden on the German state.
You know, there were Christians, Sunnis, Shiites, all living in our building. We all lived together, peacefully, side by side, like brothers. We didn't even know what denomination anybody was. We didn't ask whether our neighbors were Shiites, Alawites, or Sunnis. We just lived together in peace. My family and I were very happy in Syria. We led very contented lives. When the protests began, we were forced to flee. Our house was destroyed. It was hit by a shell. I don't know who did it, whether it was the government or the rebels.
I did nothing wrong. Our children didn't support the regime.
Or the revolution.
We lived in the heart of Damascus. Our house was destroyed.
Whenever she thinks about our house, she starts to cry. It was a beautiful house.
They took everything that mattered to me. They didn't even leave me a picture of my children. Ever since we fled to Lebanon 3 years ago, we've done nothing but suffer.
When I went back to Syria once to see what had happened to our house, all that was left was a heap of ashes. There wasn't even a single piece of wood. Just a huge pile of ashes. When I walked around the streets, I saw a few people and a young man came towards me to say hello. But before he reached me, he was hit by a shell. It tore him apart. That happened before my very eyes.
I learned at an early age that you cannot take for granted that there is a place for you on this earth. I was born to an unmarried mother in Berlin and grew up in an orphanage in Poland. On my birthday, it was the 17th of January 1945, Hitler ordered all Germans to leave Poland. In the morning, my mother appeared at the orphanage and said, "I want my child. We're fleeing Poland, and it's easier to do so with a child." My mother took me by the hand, and we went, with me pulling my birthday cake behind me on a sledge. The sky was blood red, illuminated by the fire of exploding shells. All around was the sound of artillery fire and guns. And then we were loaded onto a train, and one day the whole lot of us were taken as prisoners of war by Russians and Poles. That lasted for 2 years. One thing I remember in particular, and it's more the sound than anything else, is that when the women and children were asleep in the dormitories, we would hear the men, the soldiers, running up the stairs. And we knew what that meant. They were coming for the women. That sound is what I recall most vividly. We would lie there not knowing if we'd be chosen or not, because not all of us were. My mother was a bit older, and she knocked out a few of her teeth, so she'd look even older. She had her own way of dealing with the constant threat. She would tell me to lie on top of her and scream like mad if they came near. And that's what I always did. But there was one situation that didn't go so well, and I was the one who was raped. And then one night my mother said to me, "We'll die if we stay here. We're going to escape.
Und wir werden heute Nacht fliehen."
I'll start with the youngest, Matthäus. Matthäus, starting tomorrow, you can go to kindergarten.
Mariana,
you'll start school tomorrow. At 10 past 8 in house 45. And the other three will attend an orientation class.
A very warm welcome. My name is Martin Steinberg. I'm the pastor here in Friedland.
You're safe here. You're in a peaceful country, a country that wants you to be here. This is a peaceful country where women have the same rights as men. Where different religions coexist and people live together, celebrate together, and sing together, regardless of whether they're Muslim, Christian, or Jewish.
I was born in Syria. My father fled there from Palestine. We lived in Yarmouk. Then all hell broke loose. We were bombed. When the Free Syrian Army arrived, we fled. We crossed the Mediterranean in a dinghy. There were 56 refugees in the boat. Women and children, men. Eventually, we reached international waters. While we were still at sea, we encountered an Italian ship, which then pulled our boat behind it for hours. We fell asleep. When we woke up, we'd reached land. The women and children were the first to leave the boat. Or rather, we were all moved to another boat that had a red and white flag with a cross on it. We thought it was a Red Cross boat. But once we were all on board, it returned to sea, and we all had no idea what was happening. We were terrified it was taking us to Libya. That would have been a disaster. But we landed on Malta, which we thought was okay. We knew Malta was Europe. We all got into buses. There were a lot of camera teams and people standing around clapping. We felt welcome. But then we were taken to a police station. It was different there. The general public made us feel welcome. But the police beat us. We were all put in jail, even the families with children. In jail, some people tried to kill themselves. One man took his bedsheet and tied it to the ventilator and tried to hang himself. We got him down. They took him to the hospital. He was admitted to a psychiatric ward. Another man, his name was Muhammad Al-Attar, drank liquid chlorine. I remember his name, Muhammad Al-Attar. Someone else set his bed on fire late one evening. We were locked in, and we pounded away on the cell doors. We were afraid we would suffocate. Finally, the firemen came, and we were screaming, "Open the doors, we have to get out and into the yard." The next day, our noses and throats were full of smoke and soot. They didn't let us out. All they did was open the windows. Everything is different here in Germany. Life is completely different. The way you treat it is different. I'll never go back to Malta. I would rather return to Syria. When I was in jail in Malta, my daughter wrote something on Facebook about fleeing from one death to another. The prison on Malta is called Safi 1.
The journeys that people undertake before they arrive here are very different. Those who pay people smugglers a lot of money to get them out of their homeland reach Germany via third countries. That can be Greece or Italy, maybe Bulgaria or Romania.
countries that are known to treat refugees abysmally. But once people have been registered in those countries, in other words, they've left their fingerprints there, then it can happen that German authorities tell them that they can't stay in Germany, but they have to go back to the first EU country of entry.
Einen schönen guten Morgen. Ich bin Ihre Lehrerin. Lehrerin. Deutschlehrerin. Ich heiße Asiel. Wie heißen Sie?
Ich heiße Lofa.
Sehr gut. Klasse. Sie, wie heißen Sie?
Ich heiße Mandin.
Stellen Sie bitte Frage.
Ich heiße Sie.
Wie? Ja, wie?
Wie?
Wie heißen?
Ich heiße wie?
Wie?
Ich heiße wie?
Nein, 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 Caroline. Ach Mann, stellen Sie die Frage.
Heißen.
Wie?
Wie?
Heißen?
Heißen.
Sind Sie?
Ich heiße Jibreel.
Jibreel. Okay, Jibreel. Nehmen Sie Ihre Buchstaben. Ihre Buchstaben. Ja? Kommen Sie alle nach vorne. Nach vorne. Alle. Nach vorne. Mit Ihren Buchstaben, richtig? Ja? L. Bilden Sie ein Wort. S, C, H. Wer hat S? Mustafa, buchstabieren. D.
D.
E.
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 U.
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 U. Und zusammen lesen Sie das Wort.
Deutschland.
Deutschland. Ja?
Deutschland.
Deutschland.
Sehr gut.
Deutschland.
I'm very sad about what's happening in my country, but I'm grateful to Germany. Germany takes in so many refugees. I thank Germany with all my heart. I know we cost Germany a lot of money. My other children are arriving next month. What matters most to me is that we can all stay together. I hope we'll all be sent to the same part of Germany. I hope my children will be close to me. I've always had my children close by. This is the first time we've been so far apart.
Meine Flucht endete also Ende 47.
My journey came to an end in 1947, when I arrived in Friedland. We were given an exuberant welcome, like we were returning home. But I didn't have the faintest idea what home was supposed to be. I was used to living in camps. So it didn't feel as though I'd come home, nor did it feel like anywhere special, or that we were free. I just wondered how long we'd stay. All my mother and I had when we arrived were our rucksacks. I remember that all the other new arrivals looked really sick, destitute, and starving. The huts were terribly crowded. But we still had the feeling that we were safe, that our journey was over.
Man sei jetzt sicher und nicht mehr unterwegs.
Once you were registered, you were given an ID card that you hung around your neck that identified you as a refugee. That meant you'd come from a long way away and were entitled to be in Germany. It was a strange feeling. Shortly after arrival, the refugees were sent one by one to see the doctor. He was such a friendly doctor. I remember him well. He worked in one of the huts with a nurse. He was very kind, and of course he asked me what my name was and how old I was. My mother told him I had typhoid and dysentery and scabies. I could see that he felt sorry for me. Then he told me that I had to cut my hair because I had pustules all over my head, and that didn't work so well with lice. But despite all the confusion, there was a sense of trust and protection.
I was born in February 1944 in Masuria, in East Prussia. One day the news arrived that women with small children had to leave. And during the transport, my mother fell ill. No one expected her to die, but she did. Because my grandmother and my aunt and I had to continue the journey, we buried her then and there. And I remember Friedland. There were a lot of women sitting behind boxes of index cards, and names would be called out, and the women would shake their heads.
Und irgendwann fiel das
and
Wort
then
Weise.
Someone said the word orphan. And everyone looked at me strangely.
Dann guckten mich die Leute immer so komisch an. Das war so
they would look sympathetic.
Mitleid.
Some of them would stroke my hair or cry.
Streichelt.
But I didn't even know what an orphan was.
Ich habe aber nicht gewusst. Was das Wort Weise heißt. Dann gingen wir
then we went into a barracks where there were lots of old clothes
da waren ganz viele Klamotten. Das
hat and my grandmother picked out something for me to wear.
Damit ich was zum Anziehen hatte. Später, als ich dann nicht mehr in
later,
Friedland war, so eine
when we no longer lived in Friedland, but in the neighboring village, we'd visit the camp with a handcart to pick up old clothes.
Gegangen, da Anziehsachen zu holen. Und ich habe das
I remember that as one of the most humiliating experiences of my life. Going back home with old clothes in our handcart.
Mit dem Handwagen wieder zurück. Oh, jetzt wird's brenzlig. Wieder zurückkommen in das Dorf.
I hated going back to the village. I always felt all the people were at their windows, twitching their curtains and watching us.
Ah, ja, ja. Okay. Stopp, stopp, ganz hier. Das ist Begleitung. Das hier ist die Nummer 4. Das ist die kleine Dame.
So. Madame, here I have something different. A moment, yeah. Oh,
I remember that now and again there was talk in the village about men returning to Friedland, saying there would be prisoners of war among them. And someone asked my grandmother if she might not like to go along, and she said, none of ours is ever coming back.
Von unser Eins kommt nie nech jemand zurück.
And I thought to myself, well, who knows? My father was only reported missing. If there were new people arriving, I wanted to go and see them. I picked a bunch of flowers and decided to ride my bike to Friedland to welcome my father with them.
Und mein Vater begrüße ich mit der Kapuzinerkresse. Und dann kamen die alle.
And then I saw them coming. They arrived in trains, then buses. They waved and were so happy. The women ran alongside the buses and gave them flowers. I sat in a tree to wait. I was certain I would recognize my father. I had a photograph of him that I'd found in the suitcase we took when we left East Prussia. Or he'd recognize me. I expected him to come forward at any minute. He'd see me and take me in his arms. But no one did. I remember seeing a little boy running up to one of the men, shouting, Daddy! I thought it would be my turn next. But it wasn't. And then at some point there was no one left.
Kein Mensch mehr.
I remember I stayed there a long time, until it got dark.
Friedland is like a gateway to freedom that you go through without even knowing what freedom is. All the people who passed through here over the decades will have had a similar experience. They came here and could move about freely without a sentry standing guard the way there always was in Russia. This freedom and the warmth we were shown took some getting used to. We were housed in these Nissen huts. They're exactly as I remember them. It was always so crowded, there especially. There would be all these people standing and waiting for their relatives, their husbands, their sons. They'd be asking the men, where have you come from? Did you know of Franz Müller? And here are the women who peeled potatoes. I remember them. They made sure we all had something to eat.
Darum bemühten, dass wir etwas zu essen bekamen. Und das Bild.
This picture here. This is very moving. It says that when I left Tbilisi in early July 1947, I weighed 48.6 kilos. You can imagine what I looked like.
Dann können Sie sich vorstellen, wie ich damals mehr oder minder ausgesehen habe. Friedland war für uns eine völlig.
Friedland was a whole new world for us. There were all these people who welcomed us.
Mit uns geredet haben.
They talked to us and gave us coffee or tea or something else to drink.
Was zu trinken gegeben haben und uns dann also auch.
They found us a place to sit down, so we could have something to eat.
Um etwas zu essen. Das war ein Empfinden.
We felt as though we'd landed on another planet. The contrast to what we'd known before was so immense. I'll never forget how it felt as long as I live.
Bis ans Ende seiner Tage wird man das nicht vergessen. Man ist ja.
We floated around here like we were in a dream. We couldn't believe it was real. We touched things and say, is this really happening?
Angefasst und hat gesagt, ist das wirklich so?
Ask her why she was a refugee in Germany when she's German.
He wants to know how come you were a refugee here in Friedland, even though you're German.
That's how it was in 1945. Hitler had me deported to Poland. So we did come here as Germans, but we were East Germans. We came from the other side. We were refugees, and no one wanted us. People here were afraid. There were millions of us in those years. Silesia and East Prussia had become part of Poland, so we had to flee.
She's German, but felt like a foreigner here.
After 1947, Germany sowed the seeds of change, and now they're reaping the benefits. But we Arabs are still experiencing today what you experienced back then.
He says you were here in 1947, but that things in Germany have improved. People have changed, the political situation has changed, but nothing has changed for us. The situation has gotten worse. We're still going through what you went through in 1945.
I agree with you. But what angers me are situations like those in Malta. We Europeans, including we Germans, aren't doing enough. We've forgotten what it was like. It's shocking that such a terrible place exists in Malta and on other borders, and even in Germany, that there are camps that don't even come close to this one. Life is good for us, and I'm angry at my own country that we aren't taking more people in. We could take in more. That's what I think, as a German who was once a refugee herself.
I'm Pakistani. I had terrible problems in Pakistan. I left Pakistan because I no longer felt safe there. I was in constant danger. I spoke to a people smuggler about getting to Greece. We walked all day and all night. Along the way, they beat us like animals. If someone couldn't go on, they'd be beaten so they'd keep going. We walked across fields along the border between Turkey and Greece. Then we reached a river. The smuggler told us he had a dinghy, which we would use to cross the water. We asked him if he was coming with us, and he said no. His job was to get us only that far. It was a really big river, and there was a strong current. Some of us could swim, but others couldn't. We took turns blowing up the rubber dinghy. 26 of us got in that boat. In the middle of the river, the dinghy started twisting and rocking, and water began to get in, and the boat began to sink. We all jumped into the water. Those who could swim made it to the other side. Three didn't make it. We lost them.